here we are again. This is an exciting Sunday morning as we gather here in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of assembling ourselves together to hear the word of the Lord. We ask your blessing, Lord. We ask your divine touch, and may you be glorified. Bless the singing, the worship, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. May the Lord bless you real good, my friends. We are happy this morning to share with you some worship songs. And as our team comes, may God richly bless them as they minister to you. Please enjoy it. Please think upon it. And may the Holy Spirit bless your heart and life now.
Amen. God bless you all. Glad to have you all in attendance today. And may the Lord bless you. Aren't you glad the Lord brought you out? Amen. Somebody say amen.
Amen. Our
living room is on your couch.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out.
Oh, I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out.
Everybody.
If it had not been for Jesus, where would I be? I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out.
I've been happy since the Lord brought me out. I've been happy since the Lord brought me out.
If it had not been for Jesus, where would I be? I'm so happy that the Lord brought me out.
I've been singing since the Lord brought me out.
Oh yeah.
I've been shouting since the Lord brought me out.
If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be?
I'm so glad
that the Lord brought me out.
Aren't you glad? Oh, aren't you glad that the Lord brought you out in this hour? Aren't you glad that the Lord brought you out?
If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be? I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out.
Amen.
And he gave me peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. Oh, I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river.
I've got peace like a river in my soul.
How many have got joy?
I've got joy like a fountain.
I've got joy like a fountain.
I've got joy like
a fountain in my soul.
I've got joy like a fountain.
I've got joy
like a fountain.
It is joy like a fountain in my soul.
You know there's love like a river.
I've got love like a river. I've got love like a river in my soul.
I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy
like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul.
Even in this hour, we have springtime forever. We have springtime forever.
We have springtime forever in our soul.
Yes, we've got springtime forever. We've got springtime forever. We've got springtime forever in my soul.
Praise the Lord. Are you happy for his peace sitting there on your couch today? Are you happy for the peace and love of God in your heart when the whole world is falling apart?
Amen. There's power in his word.
Amen.
They were amazed because when they heard Jesus speak, there was power in his word.
Amen.
Let's sing the power of his love. Praise God. Lord, I come to you. Hallelujah. Today, Lord, I come to you. Oh, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me. They will be stripped away.
Amen. Everyone.
By the power of your love.
Everybody, Holy Ghost.
Oh, Holy Ghost.
And let your love surround.
Draw me to your side.
As I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle.
Like an eagle.
And I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power.
Time measured out my days. Life carried me alone. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could be gained. just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Worry not for grace. I can tell you where I would be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. And you know how that would go. All the battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to the friend who took my place and ran a course I could not start. And when he saw it full, just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I could not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I would be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. And you know how that would go. All the battles I would face,
living God. Amen. Not only was it grace to be saved, but we have grace to conquer. We have faith to conquer. Let's sing that. We've been made to conquer. Everybody, wherever you are, maybe you can stand and sing it with us together as we turn the service back to our pastor.
Oh, we've been made to conquer.
Yes, sir.
Oh, we've been made to stand.
A spotless bride,
a spotless bride that's covered. Oh, by the blood of the Lamb,
I've been made to conquer.
Oh, I've been made to conquer. I've been made.
A spotless bride that's covered
by the blood of the Lamb.
Last time we've been made,
oh, we've been made to conquer. We've been made to stand. A spotless bride.
Covered by the blood of the Lamb. Amen. bless you, Pastor.
Wasn't that an enjoyable worship service? God bless you. Now, let us turn our attention to the Word of God. Our scripture reading for today is found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, reading verse 3. Then we will read from verse 8. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till she find it? And when she had found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, Rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I had lost. Thank God. Now, of course, this is the Lord Jesus himself speaking. And as he often did, he spoke in parables. In speaking of this woman, of course, a woman in the Bible types the Church of the Living God. He is speaking in a parable of this woman whose husband has gone away from home, whether on a business trip or whether on a visit or a family trip, but he left the home and went on a trip, leaving his wife at home. Now, we realize that today in our age, when a woman is married, she normally will carry a wedding ring upon her finger. And that wedding band on her finger is a sign that that woman is a married woman. And the purpose and reason for that is to keep other men from having anything to do with her. They look and they see that she is a married woman, and if they are gentlemen, they are good men, they will respect that and realize that she is to be left alone. Now, in those days, it was not wedding bands upon the finger. But normally, a woman will have like a chain around her forehead, on her head. And in the front of the chain will be coins hanging. There'll be 10 coins hanging on that chain that would be around her head. Now, there would be those, as I said, 10 coins, and it was a sign back then that she was a married woman. Now, in our day, as I've said, a ring on the finger denotes that. Back then, in old Israel, then it was 10 coins hanging on this chain that was upon her head. And that was the sign that she was a married woman, and no man was to fool around with her or mess around with her in any way. No man, no young man was to flirt with her, because it was the sign that she was married. Now, we recognize, according to Scripture, not only was that woman a type, but the coins that she carried upon her head were also a type. and the coins, of course, on her head meant certain virtues that she was supposed to represent and live while her husband was not around. So there it was. One coin, if we might just illustrate, represented her undying love for her husband. Another coin might have represented her pledge of virtue, her pledge to live a clean and blameless life for him. And to another may be faithfulness, loyalty to him, and so on. That's the way it was. And you can find this in Galatians chapter 5, which speaks about the woman representing the church, who is the espoused wife of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the chain of coins that the true church is supposed to wear is in the Bible. It speaks clearly. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, gentleness, and patience. This is the wonderful chain that she is supposed to wear, my friends. Think of it. That's supposed to be worn by the true church of the living God. Now, think of this now. She might have been going about her business all day long, as the modern church, or as the church has gone about her business through these seven church ages, carrying along with whatever task, whatever duties that she had to do. But then, coming on to the Laodicean church age, or shall we say, coming on down to evening time, just around when it's just beginning to get dark, and one can start beginning to sense the darkness coming on, and the sun beginning to hide its face, and darkness coming up on the people and covering the nations. And so this woman, realizing that it was getting dark, she realized also that she had lost one of these coins. Now that does not sound as important to you now, but it was important to that woman at that time. So friends, I tell you, now I believe that just as much as that woman realized that she had lost the coin, I believe the church today ought to realize that she had lost something of the presence and of the power and of the Word of God. She has lost many of those virtues, not just one coin, not just one virtue, but the church today has lost many virtues that God left with her to keep and to preserve faithfully. Now, sadly, some churches, some individuals are so hardened, are so seared consciences, until they're to the point where they don't even realize that there's something wrong somewhere and something is out of line, and that they need to line up back with God's word. They need to check themselves against God's plumb line. They need to come and search their hearts against God's standards and realize, what time is it, sirs? What time is it, lady? What time is it in the history of the world? What time is it in your life and in your progress in the grace of Almighty God? Here we are. And I believe, as with the individual, so with the church, That woman began to take an examination of herself and of her position and condition. And so should the church of this hour begin to do a spiritual accounting of that what she has lost, that coin that woman lost. But today it's the virtues that the church of the living God has lost in her service and in her duty, in her love, in her faithfulness to her Lord and Savior, and her to her spiritual husband, who is none other than the living God, the Lord Jesus Christ. My friends, the clouds of destruction are hanging, looming over our civilization. Sin, sex, debauchery is everywhere. We are living in a tremendously dark time. And as we look around, we find that there is wickedness on every hand. We are in this generation where there are literally people who go to church as a sham, and people who go to church to hide their meanness and their wickedness, hiding right in the church of God. There are many others who go to church just enough to be able to profess Christianity and yet live the other part of their life. You know, it's like you can't be a black white bird. You can't be a drunk sober person. You're either drunk or you're sober. Amen. That is the way it is. But there are some professing Christians who hide in the church, professing and living under the name of Christianity, but bearing a false witness to his name and to his life and service. And so they claim to be Christians on one hand, and on the other hand, they go out into the world drinking alcoholic beverages. They go out smoking, gambling. The women immorally dressed right in the church and claiming that they are Christians, wearing even clothes that they wouldn't wear in front of their children in their own homes, but they'll wear it out in the public before the people. Oh, what a day we are living in. Oh, praise God, my brother, sister, back to the word. Brotherly love is passing away. Genuine love is passing away. Until the love of God will only be found among the members of the bride of Christ, his chosen ones, his separated ones, that will stand by the truth and by the word until the crown they gain. Oh, praise God, my brothers. The church of today has not just lost one coin, but the church has lost almost every coin. And practically everything seems to have gone from her. And it's getting on to nighttime. Watchman, what of the night? Oh my, the husband is returning. Oh, morning cometh, what of the night? The Son of Righteousness is soon to arise with healing within his wings. What are we going, you going to do, church? What are we going to do, church of the living God? Now remember, in those days, the reason and purpose for those coins upon her forehead was that if that woman was ever found untrue, unfaithful, and it was witnessed to and known by the public, reported to the priest or high priest, then she was found, one of the coins on her forehead will be taken away from her, and that was a mark that she was marked as a public harlot. Now notice, She had defiled herself. She had defiled herself and broken her faith with her husband. And so has this modern day church that we have here with us. They've broken faith with Christ, but yet wanting to bear his name, yet wanting to claim his protection, yet wanting his blessings, but will not live according to his word. And instead of having one husband, they have three, they have four, they have five. Oh my, but the Bible tells us clear, hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord, and there is only one Lord, and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Defiled herself before the people and the churches. If there's a day where the churches of our day have defiled themselves in this present world, it's now so plain, open, and obvious. No wonder the book of Revelation 18:19 speaks about the great harlot that rides upon the beast and her daughters that go with her, which is a symbol and type of the Roman church and all the Protestant groups that came out of her and organized themselves in a similar fashion with just little changes here and there to say they are different, but they have come out from her and they are acting like her, where money, 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 money becomes their greed and becomes their desire, instead, as I said last week, of being prophets of God, bringing forth prophecies. They have become profiteers. What an hour, my friends. This is no hour for us to slumber and lay asleep in a flowery bed of ease, but we are here to, with courage, fight the battle, fight against sin, fight against the things of this world, and stand for God's unchanging hand. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yes, brother, sister, she's found in such a condition. She is brought to the priest. And if she, as I've said, has done wrong, if she had been out flirting, this modern-day wicked, debauched church, no more a church that's pure to Christ, but all messed up on every hand. Think about it, flirting around with the world, seeing how much she can look like the world and still call herself a Christian, still seeing how near she could be to the world, how she could carry on with the world and like the world and still bear his name. But when you do that, you are bearing his name in vain, and you are bearing false testimony to that husband who will believe is none other than Jesus Christ himself. Yes, sir, found untrue to her husband, taking on another man's name instead of his name? Oh, that would be bigamy. But think of it, the church today, instead of taking on the name of Jesus Christ, she has every other denominational name on her doors and does not take on the name of Jesus Christ, whether it be in water baptism, whether it be in prayer, in other aspects of Christian faith. They have gone far away from the word of God. Now, when that coin is taken away, and the husband returns, when he returns, the moment he comes, if he sees one or some of those coins missing, immediately he recognizes the untrueness, the unfaithfulness, the lack of loyalty, and the lack of love for him immediately. And he would want nothing to do anymore with such a woman. He did not want her anymore. And that is a type of Christ and the church. I believe, friends, it's getting late again. And I believe Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom when the trumpets sound. The Lord himself is returning now, and we're finding this church that's false to the word, untrue to the promises of God, just using it for her own means, for money making, profiteering, fame, popularity, outward form and beauty. Oh God, have mercy upon this last day church, where we come to a great time when everything is coming to its fullness, its ripeness, its conclusion, its rottenness, whatever state it is in. It's harvest time. It's harvest time. Our Lord is calling. He's coming back. And may we be found being faithful and carrying the coins of the kingdom all upon our foreheads, and the love of God within our hearts. I believe it's getting so late that we'd better get to examining ourselves. The church has better get to a place where she's beginning to search herself and to see whether we have the holiness and the purity that the Bible requires of us, or we're just trying to have just enough of it to be able to say, well, I'm a Christian, I go to church, or I'm a believer, I read my Bible, I'm this because I did a Bible study. No, it must be between you and God, where God speaks to your heart, where your heart witnesses back that you are in line with this word. If not, my friends, you are condemned before the word of God and finding yourself in a state of chaos in this hour in which we live. Yes, sir. No, we should examine ourselves whether we're loyal to Christ or we're loyal to a church, an organization, or some group. It's not loyalty to groups or organizations or anything of that nature, but we must be loyal to Christ. Hallelujah. We associate because we have like precious faith. But other than that, our loyalty is to be to our Lord. Our loyalty is to be to this word of God. Our consecration, our devotion must be only to him. But instead, the church has become a platoon of gossipers. The church has become a great army of tattlers and tale bearers. The church has become a bunch of cigarette smokers, backbiters, and painted women of the red light district, spiritually speaking, prostitutes to the word of the living God, prostituting themselves for as much money as they can get out of the world. God have mercy upon this day and this hour in which we are living in. Oh, friends, we ought to be taking an inventory. We ought to be doing spiritual accounting. We ought to do spiritual examination. Remember, the Bible tells us judgment starts, judgment begins in the house of God. The judgment must begin here in God's house. Why? Because if we judge ourselves by God's word now, then we shall not be judged, but be passed from death into life by the grace of God. The hour is late. The coming of the Lord is upon us. Amen. And with this sense of urgency upon her, would to God the entire church, the last day church of God, would grasp it, this sense of urgency, and recognize how urgent it is in this hour of our Lord's return to earth again to pick up a bride and to take her away in this rapture which is now at hand. But and light as this woman did, for the Bible says she lit a candle and got that candle. Praise God. Hallelujah. She had a candle, she had a broom, and she had a brush. And she started doing some house cleaning. Back then it was natural house cleaning, searching for that virtue, searching for that coin, trying to find it. Oh God have mercy. So must the last day church begin to search itself, search ourselves, my friends. Oh glory to God, to find those virtues, find the faith, the loyalty, the devotion, the consecration, true sacrificial service to God, offering ourselves by faith in his mighty hand, allowing him to have preeminence over our lives, leadership and governorship over every aspect of our lives as we walk with him together. And so she started house cleaning. I believe it's house cleaning time again. I believe it's time where we ought to examine everything in our lives, in our churches, in our operations, in whatever we do and say, and ask God to show us where we have done wrong, where we have diverted from the Word of God, where we might have been enticed, where we might have gotten to a place of seduction, oh, accepting the lies of the world, of the flesh and of the devil, the pride of life and the gold of man, and taking the dollar as our almighty and bowing down to it and serve it. You cannot serve God and mammon. Back to the Word of God. Put your place, your love, your grace, your service where it belongs. It belongs to Jesus Christ, whom you call Lord, whom you call husband. Serve him, love him, serve him, walk with him, listen and obey his word, and he will bless you in every possible way. I believe if there was ever a time for us to light a candle in the dark, this is the time and this is the hour when we ought to light a candle in the dark. Amen. Light the gospel light. Oh, let us shine a light across the wave where some poor, sinking, forlorn brother that's been confused, that become fed up, desperate with what they see going on in the churches, knowing that it's wrong and that some things are wrong somewhere, and there must be something in the Bible, the Word of God, that is right, and they're seeking, but they're also seeking for help. Oh God, help every one of them out there. May we shine a light. That's what I'm trying to do. I pray God will help you and your church, that you will shine out this gospel light without fear and favor. Not for performance, not for entertainment, not for assimilation and multitudes, that you might just pull multitudes. That's not the point, my friends. The point is to take the pure word of God, and if you won by his grace one precious soul, it's worth more than a universe in the eyes of Almighty God. May God help us tonight. May God today, praise the Lord, may the Holy Spirit have his way within your heart and within your life. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. We ought to come back to a place, not just of emotions, not just fantastics, not, my friends, of having some emotional workup in the house of God, even though these things are marvelous and wonderful, but we need to get back to God and his word until we begin to have a heart-searching experience in the presence of the living God, where we say, search me, O God, and cleanse my heart today. Oh, search me, oh Savior. Amen. May the Holy Spirit search through our lives in every dark part of it. And we experience that in the presence of God. We're at the end time, friends. It's getting pretty dark. A prophet has crossed the land. And people don't understand what God has been doing in these latter times. But we ought to come to Him while there is yet time to come and surrender our hearts, our homes, and our lives, our loyalty to Him. And so she lit that her candle. And I believe every one of our candles ought to be lit tonight. I believe every one of our candles ought to be lit. And that the great Holy Spirit will shine it into some dark corner for His glory and honor. And so she got a broom. Amen. And took that broom. And my God, think of it. The neighbors could hear the work that she was doing. They could see the dust of flying. They could see the house cleaning that was going on. They could see all of that taking place, having a good old-fashioned house cleaning time. I think we need that old-fashioned house cleaning. I tell you, gospel preached again, gun barrel straight, record of the word of God. Amen. Come out of this world's chaos. Come back to the original word of God, a pure, clear, flowing stream of Christianity where the Holy Spirit cleanse you of all the carnality and all of the fleshly ambitions of success and profit and entertainment, and take away these things from the church of God and bring her back to the sobriety, the seriousness, and the soon and the urgency of the coming of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Because if she is caught, the church is caught without that one coin, she will be marked as a harlot church, a harlot to the word of the living God. So here she is, the modern church of the living God. I tell you, friends, I'm preaching to you, and I'm preaching about checking up. That means I need to check up. That means you need to check up. That means my church needs to check up. That means your church, whichever, wherever it is, needs to check up. We ought to check ourselves by the word of God and see if the things that we are being told, amen, we're being told or being whispered in our ears, whether they be true according to God's word. Is there one God or three? Is water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ, or is it in Father, Son, and Holy Ghost? Was the original sin Eve eating an apple, or was it adultery that she committed with what is known today as the serpent? What is it? Praise God. And others, we ought to search the word of God clearly to see whether what we are being told is the truth. When God says, call no man your father, and someone comes along and says, that's okay, call me father so-and-so, call me father whatever. And the very Bible tells us, thou shalt call no man father, for you have only one father, the Father which is in heaven. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Come back to the Bible. Read, I challenge you, read your Bible. Read it even if it's 5 minutes a day, and you will see what God will show you out of His blessed and holy word. May the Holy Spirit speak to you now and direct your thoughts and your heart into His word. Amen. But what we find is a church that's lax, loose, lazy, lukewarm, and lackadaisical, going about church life with no conscience, for her conscience seared with a hot iron, and until we preachers can hardly wake the church up. I don't mean just naturally falling asleep in the church, but I'm speaking about the church world of today, spiritually asleep, of the modern events that ought to be made clear by the vindication of God-sent prophecy from the presence of Almighty God. Wake up, Church of the Living God. Recognize your day and the message for your day, and recognize the church and the condition that she is in. Oh, what condition? She's in the condition saying, oh, my husband is delaying his return. My Lord delayeth his coming. And Paul tells us, and then they get to a point where they devour and bite and fuss and fight and debating scriptures and caught up with analysis of scriptures and Greek terminologies and Hebrew and Aramaic and so on, and honoring one another with man's degrees and man's things of that nature. Just think about it, friends. We are caught in this morass, this mess that we're in, a religious mess. And there we are. We see it clearly. And all these denominations have lost their light. Their lamps have gone out. And they are walking in the spiritual darkness of tradition, living in the past and living off of past victories. They're reiterating over and over and reciting over and over again past victories and living in the past. Listen, you can't drive forward while you're looking backwards. You have got to look ahead, my friends, and see what God is speaking in his word, of future events, and of the things that are going to be. We must see clearly in the word of God. May God raise up men of the tribe of Issachar, spiritually speaking, that understand the times and know how to speak to God's people to go out and to come in and to have victory over the enemies of the Lord. May the great Holy Spirit help us, everyone here today. Amen. We must tear down those walls that we have set up. We must, my friends, sweep around us with the broom of the word that God has given us. We have to scrub and clean our floors with the brush God has given to us. And my friends, we ought to light our candle and search our hearts as much as we can. And here we are, friends, the Spirit and the bride. The Spirit in the bride is now saying, come, oh, come, and together come in the presence of the living God. Now, when God gives a man a wife, we understand that man and his wife are inseparable. In the eyes of God, the Bible says they are one in him. One heart, one mind, one love, one soul, one everything. And that is a type between Christ and his church. Because God gave that wife to that man as a companion, and gave that husband to that wife as her companion. Now, friends, if a man or a woman wants to get to heaven, you must be born again. You cannot go on the way that you're living. Your lifestyle cannot continue. Your lifestyle must be changed. And the only thing that can help you and bring you through the change is Jesus Christ, giving your heart to him, confessing your faults, your sins, your failures, your trespasses to him, and he has promised he will forgive you, and you can begin again. You can start over your life again on a different footing. In the words that I have used before, you can allow him to empower you to turn all of your setbacks into comebacks. And you can come back if you rest your faith and your upon the solid foundations of the Word of God. Hallelujah. Amen. My friends, think of this. A husband coming home after a hard day's work. And when he comes into his home, he finds his wife embracing or being embraced in the, and being kissed in the arms of another man. But this is exactly what the modern church is doing to Jesus Christ, the Word of God. They're being unfaithful to the Word and messing around with the teaching and the words of man that's being whispered into her ears, being seduced and drawn away from the truth, carried away by the winds of man's doctrine and away from the original faith. Amen. The Bible says, Revelation 3:18, I am rich, I am increased with goods, and knowest thou not you're miserable, you're naked, you're blind, and don't even know it. I believe it's time for the church to light her candle once again and sweep house. Amen. I believe some preachers need to be swept out the house. I believe some church members ought to be swept out the house. I believe some Ananias and Sapphiras need to be swept out of the house. I believe we need to see a display of the Holy Spirit moving in the church of the living God when there's no man join. Be happy and rejoicing and just be frivolous about joining themselves unto them. I tell you, if you were out of line with the Word of God, they'll pack you out into the to the burial grounds, because God's Word calls for holiness, righteousness, faithfulness, joy, peace, love, long-suffering, brotherly kindness. Oh, praise God forever. May we come back to God's standards of God's Word and live by the truth until the crown we gain. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, my friend, may I ask the question? What is your spiritual condition today? What is the spiritual condition of your church today? What is your condition of your group today? May God's Holy Spirit take the word and apply it here to us. Amen. Would you say, Lord, I've heard your word, and I'm going to begin to live a different life. Lord, I'm going to be a real Bible-believing Christian. I am going to be a true believer by the grace of God, because I believe God has called me and God is calling me now. And yes, he's calling you to stop flirting around with the world. Stop flirting around with these denominational men that are out there, and to come and live for him and stay with the Word of God. Say, Lord, I repent of all of my sin. And now, Lord, I am taking you, Lord Jesus Christ. I now take you as my Savior, now and forevermore. How blessed it is to come in the presence of God. May you receive him now. Won't you receive him? Won't you come to him now? Would you take him as your Lord and Savior and say, Lord, I am searching to find that lost coin. I believe I found it today, and I rejoice in my soul, for I found the truth I've been searching for. I found the light that I've been searching for. I found the open book that I can read from, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart. God bless you, friends. It was good to talk with you today. I trust you enjoyed the entire service. God bless you. God bless you. May God lift up his countenance upon you. May he shine upon you and grant you peace now and forevermore. Amen and amen.